Louise, Bernadette, Garkovich, Penn, born in Denbo, Pennsylvania, February the 7th, 1922. When we were kids, we moved 11 times in 1 year, so it was 8 of us children born. And every time we moved to a different kind of coal mining town, a new baby was born. So we didn't stay long where I was born. Grandpa worked in his coal mines, and the coal mines would shut down. There was no work, so he'd have to go looking for work again. And he put us on a horse and buggy, and he put the stove and the beds. And you didn't have a refrigerator yet. Stove was the most important thing in your beds. And then as he put all the furniture on, he turned the chairs like upside down. And each one of us kids, he put us in one of the chairs, then tie us down. And that's where we moved. My mother left us. We were living in Uniontown. We lived with my mother's mother. We lived with her. My dad was in there with us too. But that one morning we got up in the morning and my grandmother said, my younger brother was, 4 years old, my brother Carl. He cried for his mommy. You know, I cried for mommy, where's mommy? And my grandmother says, go up to be with the girls. She come in my bedroom and Aunt Anna's bedroom. And she said, you girls have to get up. You don't have no mother no more. I said, why? She says, your mother left Jens. And the kids were young then. So we had to get up and we asked what happened. She said, she just walked out on Jens. So my dad, my mother, my grandmother called my dad. He was back in the coal mine down in Isabel. He called and said, she called him and told him, you better come on in and take your family because I can't raise them here. What was she gonna do with 8 kids? So he moved us back in the coal mining towns. And we lived in the, I didn't go back, I stayed with my grandmother. So my dad raised the kids after that, they're by themselves. She went to South Bend, Indiana. Well, my father was a nice dad. My father he taught us how to put polka. He taught us how to play he had a little mandolin. He'd play music for us. He'd sing us songs, and he taught us how to sing in our own language. See, when my dad married my mother, he couldn't talk English because he come from Yugoslavia. And he'd say to her, talk in English. She wanted to learn English. So we'd talk in English. Then when he'd ask her questions or ask us, he'd talk in Croatian to us. That's how we caught on to that language. He used to tell us we were allowed to play anywhere we wanted in coal mine towns. We weren't allowed near the river, and we weren't allowed down near the entrance to the mine. That one night we went all the way down. It was like a winding road. We went all the way down till we got down there. And my brother Mike said, there's some guys coming out of the mines. Let's wait and watch, see who comes up out of the mines. But we should never have waited. You know who came up the mines, don't you? My dad. He spotted us, said, what are yuns doing out here? It's 7 o'clock in the evening and yuns are down here in front of mine. I told you not to be down here. Go home. We knew what was gonna happen. We were gonna get a licking when we got home. He got that miner's belt and he gave us all 4 of us got a darn beating. Never went near the mines again. Never went near the river when he beat us. He said, I told you stay away from the water. I told you stay away from the mines. He was brought us up very strict, but my dad was a good dad. Had a very nice grandfather. We must have been about 6-7 years old when he died. My grandmother and my grandfather lived with us down the coal mines for a while. My grandmother used to bake bread in a big open oven out in the yard. Boy, that bread smelled good. You pull it out and cut it, then you put butter on it and melt there, homemade bread. My grandfather had the mustache come way out like this, and then he'd turn it up on the ends, you know. Would turn it, then he'd twist it, and it went like, what you call? And he contracted TB, and he was upstairs in the bedroom. Every time we come home from school, first thing we did was run upstairs and see him and comb his hair. He said, I didn't comb my hair today, and I said, you didn't. And we'd jump up on the bed there, get up there in the back, and start combing his hair. See, my grandmother, when she came over, she was pregnant with my mother. and her husband came with her, but he only stayed 6 months over here. He went back to Europe. He said he didn't like the United States. And then she married my grandpap Mogush. That was the only grandpap we remember. The other grandpap, we don't remember him. My dad was born over in Slun, Austria. November 27, 1892. He came over here when he's 21 years old. Well, when we were young, we had to raise our own vegetables. We had my dad would make beds. They're raised on the ground. Then you could walk between them. And each one of us had, I had a carrot bed to take care of, and have carrots and green beans. And I hate carrots. All summer long, we picked coal. We'd go down on the slate dump. You chop wood, we'd stab that stacked all up high, we'd have it all winter long. And then you pick walnuts, you picked. They look like a great big, about that big, a big green thing when you found them. They grew it on the trees, you'd knock them down. And when it come down, then you had to take them, when you went home, you had to break that shell off. Your hands got so brown, it stained your hand. You couldn't get that off unless you put Clorox on your hands. And we'd break them off, and then on top of our coal shanty, Dad pulled us, made a piece of wood, like slanted. We'd put all them walnuts on there and let them sit out in the sun till they'd dry up. You know, the outside shell, and after it dried up, then you put them in a sack and brought them into the basement. And when you broke them, they were black walnuts. Oh, did they make the best candy that you know? Every time my mother would go out to visit her lady friend, we would watch. She'd be down two houses down. Out came the pots and pans off the stove. We were always cooking candy. We'd make black walnut fudge, taffy. You should have seen us when we made taffy. My God, we was pulling taffy all over the place. There was happy times when we did that. When I was in seventh grade, we walked from Isabel to Brownsville. That's 8 miles to see a movie. And we asked our mother, could we go? She said, no. My dad would tell us no too, because he's afraid that something would happen to us, you know? So that one day, my brother Mike was an instigator. He said, but we would pick rags and bones for the junk man to come, then we'd get money. We got money, then it's when we went to the Boys' Club. So we asked our mother, could we go? And she said, go ahead. So we walked. It was storming. And when you went past them, you know, them big high tires with electricity, that hum is all the time. My brother, he'd say, when you go past there, you can get lightning's gonna strike you dead. You have to run real fast past there. Man, we'd come past it, we'd run like anything past there so we wouldn't be struck dead in that spot. We believed everything my brother told me. He was 2 years older than me. If I had to listen to him, he'd beat you up. We used to go every Joel McRae movie that was on. I don't know the name of them, but we didn't miss a Joel McRae movie. Only cost you a nickel to go in. You picked rags and bones and everything from the junk man. You got money, then you went down to the store and bought yourself some candy. And we'd always look where you can get 2 for 1 penny or 3 for a penny. The more you got, the better. The big old jawbreakers. The jawbreakers are about that big. You could cut them in half or bite them in half and have for now, chew it, and later on you had another half, and you got 2 of them for a penny. My dad said he didn't believe in girls going to high school. The boys could go and graduate, but not the girls, because he says, you're gonna get married and take care of kids. The boys did have a career. I finished 8th grade. Him and his cousin was living in the same house where my grandmother was living. And that's where they were living there. And then we went in to see my grandmother. That's when I really met him in there, in with my grandmother's. Guy said, that's the guy I'm gonna get married to. I like him. He was looking at other girls and I'm thinking, well, I'm not old enough. But once we moved in with my grandmother, then he started asking me to go out. We went roller skating 3 times a week. I roller skated, he roller skated. And then we went dancing. We liked to go dancing. We'd sightsee. We used to go around every different place. Like, yeah, cool folks went. There was lots of places my grandmother would say, your mother's gonna holler, your dad's gonna holler. And I didn't care. I went anyhow. 14 when I got married. He was 24. I got married up in Detroit. And we were staying with his cousin, and we got married in the house there, and we had just a small wedding in the house. I stayed in Detroit for a year, and then I come back to Uniontown. And then my grandmother told us, why don't you take that? You're expecting? I said, yeah. She said, well, come on home and have the baby here. And I lived with her till I'm up, like I say, I had three kids before I left. Three were born in Uniontown on 15 Maple Street. That's where they were born. Then when I had Maryann, I had her down in Greensburg. I had her at home. So when I got pregnant with Johnny, the doctor said, no, you gotta go to hospital. Grandpap says, they'll sure as heck give you the wrong baby. And I said, no. Wouldn't you know they did bring the wrong baby in? And he says, you sure it's ours? I said, I don't know. But I had them four kids at home. And each one only cost me $25 to have them. That's all the doctor charged you. When my period stopped, well, I'm pregnant. Most girls tell me that I was pregnant. Then I waited till I was, about 4 months, 5 months pregnant before I went to the doctor. And I said, am I pregnant? Yes, you are. And the minute that I'd start in labor, I'd call him and he'd come to the house. And he'd sit there while I'm walking back and forth in the halls. We had a long haul with my grandma's. I could walk back and forth. And I'd say, oh, I'm tired, I'm gonna go sit down. No, keep walking. My grandmother says, keep walking, that's good for you. She was old fashioned, you know, keep walking. Her and the doctor would sit there, walk some more, back and forth. That's all he did for you. Just walk. Grandpa was right there beside me, holding my hands. He helped make them, he's gonna help me pull them out. You know what it's all about. He kept saying, and I said to him, no more babies. He says, don't you want another one? No more babies. Not even 2 years later, I have another one. My grandmother, see, she's old fashioned. I lived with her, and she'd always say when I got pregnant, she'd talk broken, she'd go catch another boy. I said, look at her. I said, oh my goodness, no. I've got two boys, we want a girl. She would tell me all the time what I was gonna have. But I was shaped different. With the boys, I was all out in front. With Maryann, I looked like a round tub. Oh, he was in the height of his glory. He had a girl. He named each one of the boys. He had a name picked for them. I'd be pregnant, he'd reach over and pat my tummy. How's little Tommy doing? How's little Danny doing? And I thought, oh, gee, here he goes with these boys' names. So I said to him, I'm shaped different. Maybe we have somebody else. And he says, we got a name picked for her. And I said, what? He said, we'll name after your grandmother, Maryann. He was in the height of his glory whenever he got a little girl. Well, when she was about third grade, you could see that. Because she drawed then. She did real good. She should have went, because they told her to send her to Pittsburgh to art school and everything. Well, we couldn't afford to send her down there. So she did all she could right here in school. But she had a mind of her own. When she said she was going to do something, she's going to do it. I'll tell you, this was her, whenever she lived here, this was her bedroom. And her grandpa says, you're not going out? She'd go out that window over there, out onto the roof, climb down to the roof and go to the ball game. Then come back home and climb up that roof and come over here and over here. We never knew she went out of the house. Till he found out one day that she was too tired, I guess, to climb the roof. He went to work that morning and he said he'd seen something. The glider was on the front porch and she must have moved. He picked up the glider and he saw her sleeping underneath there. He didn't say nothing, but he says, I'll fix her. He nailed the window shut so she couldn't get out. But every time she wanted to go out, she snuck out. Grandpa was working as he peddled fruit. His cousin was in a fruit business, and he'd go from house to house selling fruit and that. we had the car first. And whenever he wanted to go sell apples, he took the back seat out of the car, dumped 30 bushel apples in the back, went out and peddled them in another coal mining town, you know, to see if he could get rid of them. Then if we went the next day and like Sunday roll around and we wanted to go out for a ride, that car smelled from apples from here to I don't know where. We were living in Uniontown and he said, it's time to move. That's too much on me to travel from Uniontown to Duquesne. And he moved, we moved down this way. He was a millwright in the steel mills. Worked repairing electric furnaces, 43 years. $5.92 a day with four children. We had a car payment, a refrigerator payment, and a stove we bought. By the time you paid all that, you had nothing left over. Well, I'll tell you, went over Kennywood, and there was only one ride over there, the merry-go-round. That's all we could afford with all them kids. Let's go to the merry-go-round, round and round. Do you want to get on it? I went two times. I'd get sick at the end of my riding on her, but the kids thought it was great. My kids didn't go barefoot. They didn't go out without no clothes. I told them, you got to buy me a sewing machine because the kid, you know, the boys wear the knees on the pants. I said, you'd have to patch their pants, sew for them. And I said, they'll never go with their, like a lot of people, you had seen them with holes in their pants. No, I patched it. They had good pair of pants to go to church on Sunday. There's your pants patched for playing. When you went to school, you didn't have patches in your pants. First vacation, Bridgeport, Connecticut. My sister lived in there, my older sister Ann. She got married and moved up there, and then we decided, she said, why don't you just come up? And then we had 2 weeks vacation, and that's where we went up to see her. It took us 14 hours to get there. Packed a big lunch, you know. Must have been 30 sandwiches in there. By the time we got up there, well, Johnny, every time you went around the corner from here to up there in the corner, I'm hungry. We're not even out of Pennsylvania. We're not even around the corner. You're hungry already? He knew there were sandwiches there. He's going to eat. So he eat as well. And then him, I sat in the back seat with him all the time because I'd let Marty and her two boys sat up front and I would sit with the three other ones in the back. And we would play cards. He learned to play poker when he was 4 years old. He'd beat you at every game there was, but I kept dealing out and let him play poker as long as it kept him busy. Grandpa liked his Chevys. I remember it was an old green one. It wasn't real old, but I mean, didn't buy brand new, but a used car and it was in good condition. Grandpa had a favorite song when he drove, Streets of Laredo. He'd be singing that. He'd hum it and then he was singing it. Hum it and then sing it. And then Red River Valley was another one. And I'd say to him, don't you know the words to any other song beside him? He said, nope, don't know any other words. We went a good bit up Uniontown because his sister Mary lived up there. And when you go up and all the horses that you saw on this side there, whoever sat on this end of the car, they counted. Who sat on my side, see, Grandpap's side and my side. And then they'd say, I saw one, I saw one. I says, where? And they'd have to prove it. If you lied, I says, no lying. Then we'd see who won. And if they won, then that's the side that'd have to buy the ice cream cone. We moved in this house November of 51. We've been in here ever since. I cooked every day, big meals. Gray big meals. They used to squawk because whenever I bought liver, I made them sit down. You're eating that liver or you're going to bed. Because liver is good for you. I try to feed them foods that are, should be eaten. Sunday, for instance, you'd have chicken or you'd have spaghetti or roast or something like that. During the week, we'd have regular meals, you know. But you'd to make sure the kids ate real good. Everybody liked fried potatoes. And when I fried potatoes, I have a big skillet. I'd fry everybody a skillet full. By the time it was time for me to eat, I would look at it. I ain't frying myself potatoes. I would nibble on the ones that I was frying. Marty got married first. I remember when he got married, he was going to move out his clothes. Grandma looked at me and he said, "What's the matter?" And I said, I can't take this. He said, "You better go to the movie." Me and Johnny went to the movie. We stayed there while he moved his clothes out. I would not stay while he's moving out. When Tom did the same thing, each one of the kids got married. I went, me and Johnny went to movies. We didn't want to be here when they were moving out. You know, with a house full of kids, you think you wouldn't miss them? It was lonesome without them kids in here. Marty left and Tommy left and Danny. Within 3 years' time, all three of them was gone. And Maryann was in here for a good while. She was a good kid, very nice. Giggle, laugh, her and Marty Joe would sit here. They'd be giggling, and I'd go, "What are you giggling about?" They'd come down and they'd say, "Grandma, do you need your cupboard?" I had the cleanest cupboards in town. They'd say to Grandpa, "We're going to clean cupboards for Grandma." And I'd say, "Okay." If they clean cupboards, I'd give them a couple bucks. I didn't know Grandpa was giving them a couple bucks, too. I said, they'd say, straighten up all the pots and pans and drawers, everything. Whatever I, when I work, they work right along with me, him and Michelle. They're good kids. So every weekend, for 5 years, I had them here. They didn't miss a weekend that they weren't here. And as soon as they come in the door, Grandpa reached in his pocket, gave me each a dollar, they can run up the store to buy themselves ice cream. I said, "Where's my dollar?" He said, "You don't get nothing, just them." Your mother says, we'd go over to her place. She had an old car. She said, "We're going to go shopping." We'd go up Zayers at that time. We'd go up there and she'd look at a coat over there. I think I like that one. "Let's go up on Route 30 up at Kmart. Let's go up and see what they got." We went up there, and every time we went past that Dairy Queen, Michelle and Marcia and I had an ice cream cone. We went out there, she didn't like that coat. "What did that coat look like over there?" "I don't know." So she took us back, we looked at that one. "Well, I think that would look better." We went 3 trips back and forth each time we went. We didn't care how many times she wanted to go look at them. We got an ice cream cone. I said, I'll buy you an ice cream cone. So we'd buy an ice cream cone. So anytime we went anywhere, "Are we going past that store?" "Heck yeah, let's buy an ice cream cone. What do you think I got away with fat for?" We had a good time. Well, we'd go down to Renzi and play around down the top, take them down the park down there. That was big for them. Marcia was very vibrant as a kid, you know, peppy, jumpy, all that. Michelle knows she could be like your Danielle, sit there and read a book or play cards or something like that. Or her and I could sit and watch TV. But Marcia was always on the go, all the time on the go, you know? Well, every time I had to go over there and take groceries over your mother's, I had to sneak him over there because she was going home with me. She was a lovable kid. She called yesterday and I told her, I answered her phone. I says, "Marshmallow, what are you doing?" She said, "Nobody calls me Marshmallow but you." You know, had Grandpa been sick, that would prepare me for something. That was the worst blow I could have had. Your dad and your mom, they knew some people. I don't know where it was, on a farm someplace. I can still remember this. It was a house and had white fence all around, like where they raised horses and had them corralled in. They were having a big picnic out there and they said, "Jim's want to go?" And Grandpa said, "Yeah, let's go." So we went out there. Your dad says to him, "Hey, Dad, you want a glass of beer?" And he said, "Oh, I don't know." He said, "I quit drinking beer." "Well, let's have a glass of beer." He went in and had one glass of beer, brought him out a beer. Your mom and dad got up and was dancing a little bit, and we were standing there watching them, you know. So coming home, your mother and dad was walking ahead of us, and Grandpa's laughing. He says, "Watch that, Maryann. She was acting silly. She was, you know, bumping your dad with her hips, you know, singing and bumping your dad as she's going along here." And Grandpa put his arm around me and he said, "Oh, this is like Lover's Lane walking down here. Next year we're going to come back, aren't we, Dawn?" He said, "Yes, we are." You know, we came home that night. I come in, they dropped us off. I come in. I remember going through the hall over here. And I said to him, "You go in the bathroom first and I'll go." I went, and he's coming out. I kissed him in the hall over there. I said, I had a good time tonight. He said, I did too. I didn't say no more to him. Went to bed. Next morning, I heard him breathing. I thought he was snoring. By the time I realized it sounded funny, I jumped up. I'm screaming. That, my world, fell apart right then and there. Nobody knows. I didn't tell my kids how I felt, but they know I missed him. But I said, it was so lonely in this house, I could not take it. 6 months after he died, whenever I was going walking in the hall over here, I was coming out of the bathroom and I was crying and I fell and I broke my arm. Just the way I tripped on that rug. I had to go down to the doctor's down there and looked at it, and he said to me, how'd this happen? Was you crying? I said, yeah. He says, you're going to go to work. I says, I never worked a day in my life. He says, you're going as a volunteer. So I went in and I worked 15 years now, and that kept me going. Otherwise, I'd come home and all I did was sit and cry. I went to the cemetery every day. My kids didn't know this. I went every day and every day. I'd look around and I said, am I going to spend the rest of my life in this cemetery? I got to stop this. So I went as long as I could till it snowed that one day. I couldn't go to the cemetery. I thought my world went apart. I couldn't go to the cemetery. Then from then on, I learned to back off a little bit more. Then I joined the AARP and I got to traveling. I didn't have no friends, no lady friends, nobody. So little by little, I knowed other people. I started traveling with them. Then I was president for 2 years. Then after being president, and I went in with the tours, I helped them, then I started traveling even more. And that got me out of that. But otherwise, I wouldn't have been able to make it. That was, to be only 54 years and be, I know there's other women are, you know, they lose their husbands a lot younger than I did, but for me to lose him like that, I just could not comprehend it. Why did he die? Then when Johnny died, that was even worse. My grandma used to tell me, you can lose a mother or father, sister, brother, you're gonna miss them. But when you lose a child, I'm telling you this to your, telling you, Donnie, if you lose a child, it's part of your body, and it, you got a pain in your chest, you don't know why you feel like you do. My world fell apart when I buried him. And that was hard. He is sadly missed. I don't mean to cry, but it's... One of these days, I'm going to go see him, Donnie. It's been 5 years, but it ain't going to go away. It'll never go away. I have other children, but him, it was different with him. See, he came home to live with me 8 years after his daddy died. He was up in Maryland working. So then he asked me, he says, Mom, can I go home and live with you? So I told him, stay here. As long as I'm eating, you're gonna eat. I cooked for him. I never had to wash a wall, never had to scrub nothing. He scrubbed this house down. He'd work steady night shift. I'd be sleeping in bed and I'd come home at 6 o'clock in the morning, 7 o'clock in the morning. He'd say, okay, Mom, let's get up and start working. I said, what are we doing now? We're gonna wash these walls down. Every spring, the walls had to be washed down. The rug, weekends, we had to run the sweeper. We did it. He pushed me. You know, come on. And the more he pushed me, the more I worked. I never had to work, do nothing else.
This is a new tape recorder I just bought. It helps me pass the times away like this. The days go faster for me, and that's what I think I want. The winters are going to be long this year, I think. Won't be able to get out of the house very much. Oh well, I'll be able to play my recordings and listen to what the kids have to say. Boy, I should have had this tape recorder when Grandpa was living. We could have heard his voice, could have played it, could have heard him talking to Grandma. Maybe if anything ever happens to Grandma, you'll be able to hear my voice. And I hope you always remember me. And maybe when you do hear my voice, you don't listen to me already, because Grandma's going to be mad at you if you don't be good. Well, good night. We'll talk some other day.
If I never had a problem, I would know my God would solve them. I never know what faith in God could do. Through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus, learned to trust in God. Through it all, I've learned to depend upon His word. On His word.